You know, we're learning all this. I'm learning all this new stuff I have to do.
Of
and that remains in an intimate relationship with Jesus. What is needed on this Lent journey, in this very pandemic that we're living in,
yes,
is that we are to live into the basic foundation of Christianity. Mm-hmm. The real word for today, it gives us light that we are to live as Christ will have us to live.
Yes.
The song says, I can hear my Savior calling. That's foundational principle number one, living for Christ.
Yes.
That we have to find a way to listen to God.
Yes.
No longer making excuses and decisions separate from the will of God.
Yes.
In this very relationship, we'll bear and cross from time to time, as the song says, where he leads me, I will follow. We will face criticism, whether we like it or not. We will be unfairly judged, whether we like it or not. All while we will be defenders of what is true and right. We will still face criticism. You know, but this is a normal life, isn't it?
Yes.
When you stand for right, somebody will tell you you're wrong, that you're old-fashioned, that you're not in touch with society. The song says, I'll go with him through the garden. Jesus went to the garden to pray, and he even asked his disciples, would you just pray with me for 1 hour? And he fell asleep. A true disciple is one, I'm just giving you some foundation here for what it means to be a disciple of Christ. A true disciple is a praying disciple. To follow means spending time in prayer with God.
Yes.
And the next verse of that song says, I'll go with him, all the way through the judgment. Now when I hear that, I say that that's for a person who has a made up mind. A person with a made up mind has a position of disposition of, I will not turn back. Once I have put my hand to the plow, I will not turn back, no matter what judgment comes my way. I like the baseball analogy. My son played baseball from 4 years old up until he was about 18. And one of the things I remember the coach saying, hey, if you want to commit. Now don't get caught on your face and running back and forth, because you're going to get thrown out. And that's what we have to do when we are serving the Lord, when we're living into the very principles of God, that we have to commit to what we're doing. No matter what judgment comes our way, no matter what criticism comes our way, no matter how tired and sleepy we become, we have to commit ourselves.
Yes.
Amen.
We started our 2021 Lenten journey headed to the cross. In the midst of this 2020 and beyond pandemic, we don't know when this thing's going to end. This thing is still reshaping our lives and our very world.
Yes.
We began our 2021 Lenten season in Psalms 51. And we heard David crying out, create in me a clean heart. Lord, help me to be a forgiving person.
Yes.
And that's our focus, one of our focuses in this Lenten season, that we remove unforgiveness from our lives. We will allow the
are listening to the Spirit say to us, commit your life to following Christ. The last verse of that very cherished song, "Where He Leads Me, I Will Follow," says, He would give us grace and glory and go with us all the way. We could be encouraged that God will walk with us and never leave us. No matter how hard the road is, no matter what we have to face in life, no matter the judgment, the criticism, God will go with us all the way. God's presence remains with us in, because we are in a relationship with God. You know, we hear a lot in our world today about follow. We hear a lot about that in the social media world. Follows are distinct from likes. So it sums up that you can go to click on in Facebook and so forth. A follow indicates a higher level of engagement. That's subscribing to hear more of someone's message. It gives more value than those just a thumbs up or a smiling face.
Yes.
Biblically, to follow is used in both the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament.
Yes.
And it highlights various aspects of discipleship. For the Israelites, the people of the promise of the and the covenant, to follow God was a matter of both trust and obedience.
Yes.
It meant keeping the commandments and obeying the prophetic word. In the New Testament, believers were exhorted to follow Jesus' commands, ways, and sound doctrine. Our very submission of our New Testament is telling us that when we submit to the incarnate Son of God, it changes our identity. It brings us into a closer, loving relationship. So there's always another side. Our natural born tendency towards self-reliance and human wisdom interferes with our desire to follow. Seeing in the text, Jesus is dealing with those struggling to live committed lives. They knew the one who could feed a crowd with a single sack lunch. They knew the one who could calm a raging storm with a word, or hang out on a mountain with prophets that lived hundreds of years ago. What Jesus showed, however, was that coming to him on any terms and timing other than his own was completely, you hear this now, out of question. Discipleship, unfortunately, means certain loss. While this is a very sobering reality, it is put into perspective that disciples also gain. They gain everything in Christ. It's like when you lose something in some. Am I right?
Yeah.
We lose some things, we win some things. Discipleship on our Lenten journey calls for us to fall in line. Discipleship frees us from living into a wishy-washiness of self. One day I'm hot, and the next day I'm cold. One day I'm served with energy and imagination, the next day I can't be found. On one hand, the fist is open, serving the Lord with gladness, and on the other hand, the fist is closed tightly, work towards keeping it. A young man asked the old man, a young married man, newlywed man, asked the old man one day, "How did you stay married so long?" And the old man simply said, "I kept coming home." It sounds so simple. And you know, following Jesus, Jesus said, "My yoke is easy. Pairing up with me is easy." And he said, "My burdens are light." I talked with elderly, a servant of the hospice chaplain. I talked with the elderly, and from them I get a sense that the best time to do things is the present time. Don't put off today for today. How they go? Don't put off today.
Don't put off tomorrow what you can do today.
I remember one time talking to this particular lady, and what I found in my serving as a chaplain is that the men like to talk about their jobs, how they were productive, you know, hard working. But the women like to talk about vacations. And one particular lady, she said to me, "You'll never regret going on vacation." She said, "The money is now right, but go anyhow." Another lady said to me with tears in her eyes as she held her husband's hand, she said, "The golden years may not be so golden as you hope for." So what I take from that, do what you need to do right now. Don't put off today.
Don't put off tomorrow what you can do today.
Y'all know what I'm going to say right here.
Mm-hmm.
In life, changes come. The future is unpredictable. So now is the time for good people to do good things. Now is the time for good people to do good things. They're on that road with Jesus where people struggling, looking backwards instead of looking forward, and making a right now decision to follow. You know, they have the thumbs up. "We like you, Jesus." But Jesus, we just can't follow you all the way. We just, right now, Jesus, we can't subscribe to you fully. We can't submit to you as you request. Right now in our lives, we can't give a higher value or value in our life than we have other engagements that we value more than serving you right now. It's not socially acceptable for me to serve you right now. I may lose something or someone's friendship in the process if I strive to serve you right now. Who likes the songs, "Boy to Myself in the Lord"? Who sang that more than once? And Kirk Franklin's song, "I'd Rather Have Jesus Than Silver and Gold." That's what we're making when we sing those songs. We're saying we want to commit our lives to Jesus. On the road while hearing Jesus' response, I'm sure it must have felt very narrow when those men heard the response that Jesus gave to their statements. I'm sure their eyes started shifting from left to right as they were looking for an exit off that narrow road. One of them started a conversation, and I have no idea why would you start a conversation with Jesus like this. Because you know he's going to come back and come to me. "I will follow you," he said, "wherever you go." And Jesus knew his heart. Jesus spoke to this person's comfort level. Okay, wait a minute. He spoke to my comfort level, saying, "The road is rough, and the going will get tough, and the hills are high, hard to climb. I have no home. Foxes have homes, but I have no home. When I started, I left or are you just waiting for everything to be passed out to you on a silver platter? Jesus said, then turned to another saying, follow me. His response was, I will follow. And here we go. What? I must first bury my father. Jesus knows all things, challenges him by saying, let those who are spiritually dead bury the dead. But you who are spiritually alive, come follow me. Go preach the gospel.
Yes.
Saying, wherever you are, whatever you have, not later, but do it now. It's tight. This word is tight, but this word is right. What Jesus takes us to, my pastor back in Armour, North Carolina, said, whatever Jesus takes you to, he'll lead you through.
Amen.
Told me that when I was on my way to seminary. I didn't want to go. I didn't want to leave home. I didn't want to leave my job. I didn't want to leave the comfort that I was having. And I feared giving up the home, giving up the job. I feared not having, being a widow, and not having my husband with me, and I've had a junior high school child, and I'm going to seminary. I feared having relied on somebody else to pay my bills, my tuition. I feared that. And he told me, whatever Jesus leads you to, Jesus will lead you through, and he certainly did. But I won't say it was easy. It was not easy. Because trusting God is not easy. God likes to wait sometimes and laugh at it. That car coming now. Then another on that road said, I will follow you and call him Lord. But first he said, let me go and say goodbye to those at my house. This sounds like he is on the fence with this decision and is using his family as an excuse to not continue on that journey. I wonder how many of us have used
Amen.
We have stopped some of the old ways, taking on new things. And quietly, we are wondering in our minds, what's the next wave of change that will hit? And will we be able to adjust to the next wave of change? What are we holding on to? This is a linked question. What are we holding on to that prevents us from changing? What COVID taught us and is teaching us is that we can change. Presbyterian Executive of the Presbytery said at the end of COVID-19 in 2021, he said, I used to say that the church cannot change. He said, but now I see that the church can change. We can live differently. I say to you, let this word speak into your life. We have a road to try. Let us walk it with Jesus. When we let go and when we let some of the walls down in our lives, get off the fence of indecision, free ourselves from excuses. When we let go of self-reliance and self-confidence in ourselves, when we let go of Jesus as being socially unacceptable, only worthy of a thumbs up and never a deeper commitment of following, when we let go, coming to terms and timing that match God's timing and terms, we'll know that we are relying on God, that we have confidence in God, that God is getting us through the journey, that God is getting us through this Lent season, that this life, this pandemic life that we are living into, God will bring us through, because our lives are ever changing. Amen, church.
Amen. Always.
Beside me,
Praise God.
Amen.